Technology is not good or evil. It is on us how we use it. Welcome, namaste, and vanakkam to Navratri Tech Talks, organized by Mahindra Technical Academy in association with Prasiddhi Forest Foundation. So today is our fifth day. Our last few days were wonderful, and today's session is very important, as we have an amazing speaker, Sanaya, and I have a very important announcement to be made at the end of the session. So hold on till then. And now let's begin with our amazing journey of today's session. So I request Mr. Vinay Nair to introduce today's genius.
Thank you, Prasiddhi. And a very good evening to all of you. I'm very happy to interact with you all here. My name is Vinay Nair. I'm one of the co-founders of Raising a Mathematician Foundation. And those who were part of the earlier meetings, I would have said, about Raising a Mathematician Foundation in a few words, but I would like to just present some other ideas today. I thought, otherwise it will be the same stuff I'm talking about every day. And the listeners might get a little bored. So we are a not-for-profit organization, and one of the things that we do is introduce different flavors of mathematics to students at a young age. And talking of today's talk, I think what we have been doing is something very important to what Sanaya is going to speak about. So I remember my school days when we were introduced to economics, and there would be maybe one or two out of the entire batch of probably 300, 350 students who fell in love with economics, and rest of them never could find a connect to what economics was all about. But then there is a lot of interesting aspects to economics, a lot of interesting problems that economics has in store, a lot of problems where math can be used to solve problems in economics. And these kind of ideas, if we can introduce to students while they are in school, they'll be able to connect it to it and, in much better ways. And they might even like to pursue something, on those lines earlier. So one of the programs that Sanaya had attended that we had done, when she was probably in fifth or sixth grade, was application of math in finance and economics. And that was a module that was meant for older students, but then she just came and sat in the session, for 2 days, she listened to it, and probably some seeds were sown in her hearts, in her heart. And over a period of time, she also learned some areas of computer science. And then she could find some kind of connection between math, computer science, and economics. So she is a hardcore lover of all these three subjects. And I'll now move on to introducing Sanaya. So I've known Sanaya since probably 6 to 7 years now. And she has been an amazing student. She has a lot of accolades to her credit, starting from ranks in different Olympiads that she has got, getting selected for the Indian National Mathematics Olympiad, and so on and so forth. One thing that I strongly like to say over here is, and something that is something similar to Sai's introduction, which I did yesterday. So Sanaya, when she was in ninth grade, I think she attended a course on foundations in computer science, a course on algorithms, actually. And then she got a chance to do a course, a summer program at Princeton. And many of you would know Princeton is one of the best colleges all over the world. And she was invited to do a course over there with about 100 students across the globe who are very bright and passionate about mathematics. And that was her 10th standard, okay? So you know how 10th standard is usually in India. And then, there is a lot of things going around in the school, at home, and things like that. And she really wanted to go for this. It was a golden opportunity for her. But then it was a tough thing to convince, you know, the school authorities that it is worth going and attending this program by skipping school while we are in 10th standard, which was a strict no-no. So I remember Sanaya taking that extra effort and trying to go do a lot of meetings. And, you know, thanks to her mother also, she also went with them, and they managed to convince the school that, you know, she will do her studies, she will stress herself, she will do that. And then she too went to attend this course, 1 month program in the US. And when she was doing the basic course over there, seeing how passionate she was in mathematics, she was also given an opportunity to sit in the advanced batch and learn two topics at one go. So that's where Sanaya is coming from. She's coming from the place where she's coming with a lot of inclination towards learning mathematics, and not just doing a lot of problems that we normally discuss in school, but looking at where and how math can be applied and math can solve real world problems, right? I mean, that is something that we all would want to do, right? Solve real life problems, real world problems. So I'm really excited. It's unfortunate that I won't be able to sit through the entire talk, but I'm sure all of you would really love the kind of flavor that she is going to bring on the interesting real life problems that connect economics and mathematics. So with that, I'll not eat up her time. I'll hand it over to Sanaya. Sanaya, over to you.
Thank you so much for the very nice introduction, and Prasiddhi, for you as well, for hyping me up. It was really nice. So I'll start sharing my screen. Today's, I'm going to talk about introduction to mathematical thinking and then how it intersects other fields. Can you give me a thumbs up if you see the screen? Okay, great. Awesome. If you want, you could grab a pen and a paper maybe, because in halfway mid there, maybe you will want to like scribble something down to see, because we will be playing games sort of. So you might need those. So if you want, you could just go and grab a paper and a pen and we can start. Okay. So introduction to mathematics, mathematical thinking. So what is mathematical thinking? The whole concept of when we say, or how we perceive in school of mathematical thinking, is formulas, calculations, geometry, algebra. But it is not limited to that. It is majorly the way you look at things, stripping them down to their essentials, seeing patterns of how they work, and then analyzing those patterns and figuring out stuff and seeing the beauty in them. And once you get the knack of doing this, math is art. It is no more, it's no more all dull and like calculative. It's not. You will love doing that. So in fact, we all do mathematical thinking on a daily basis. Doesn't matter what field you are in, what you're doing, which grade you are in, it's a part of our daily life. We just don't seem to realize it. Let's give an example that maybe most of y'all will relate to. How many of y'all have played the game 21 numbers, also known as the tooth and dare, in schools? Give a thumbs up if you have, chat box, anything. So, okay. So this game, if nobody knows what it is basically a game where you say numbers, either one, either two or three numbers consecutive, and the person who says the number 21 loses. So the game, the strategy that is used in this game is known as the NIM game technique. Most of us might be doing this technique already without knowing it, that we are actually doing it. But what you're doing is actually mathematical thinking. So what is exactly the definition, per se definition, of NIM game techniques? It's a technique used where the player defines the goal first and then starts working backwards, trying to determine how to start the game so that the goal can be achieved. So over here in the previous game, it would be, I have to make sure that I'm not the one saying the number 21. That's my goal. So I will work backwards to figure out how to start the game so that I can guarantee myself that I will not be the one saying the number 21. Because this is a very common game, let us start with something different. So this is the point where I said y'all might have to grab a pen and a paper. So let me first explain the question. Ki and Ka are playing a game where they both have to alternatively add numbers from 1 to 10. Whoever reaches the sum 100 wins. Okay? So just in case the words aren't that clear, let's say me and Prasiddhi are playing a game and we both have to alternatively choose numbers between 1 to 10. So let's say I start with number 1 and then Prasiddhi chooses 3. So till now, the sum is 4. Okay? Then I say the number 5. So now the sum is 9. Now whoever reaches the sum 100 wins the game. Okay? Now, could you all text or put it in the chat box if you think this is a random luck game because you don't know what the other person is going to say and there's a 50-50 chance of both of you winning, or you can actually guarantee a win in this game? A lot of guarantee win. I think you can guarantee a win with a strategy. Yeah.
Can I ask something?
Yes, sir.
Can you play this with somebody? Maybe Prasiddhi, yeah, and
I
you
was,
can
I
play
was just
a one round.
About to do that. I was just about to do that. Okay. Prasiddhi, will you volunteer for this?
Sure.
So let's say I start with number 1.
Okay. Number 5.
So we are at a sum total of 6. I say 6.
Okay. I'll go with 8.
Go with 8. I go with 3. So we are at 23.
Okay. I'll go with 11.
You can't choose 11. It's 1 to 10.
Okay, yeah, sorry. Probably I'll go with 9.
9. Then I go with 2. So now we are at 34.
Okay. Then I'll go for 4.
Okay, and I'll go for 7. So now we are at 45.
I go for 2.
Now I go for 9. So we are at 56.
I'll go with 3.
I go with 8. So we are at 67.
I'll go with 9.
I go with 2. We are at 78.
5.
I go with 6 and we are at 89.
I'll go with maybe 10.
So you are at 99 and I say 1 and I win. Okay, so I guess who is this? Okay, David was writing all the sums. Thank you so much. Can everyone just see the chat box and maybe try to see if you can see a pattern of how the sums were adding up? I guess he has put it, yeah, he shared it with everyone. That shouldn't be a problem.
I do see one hand up. By David, a Christian. Okay.
Yeah, okay. So, David. Is his hand still up? I can't.
No, no more.
Okay, so I guess Joshua has said something. Joshua, could you unmute yourself? I'll
So I'll just allow them to unmute, but they have to raise their hands. So only then I'll be able to unmute them.
Okay. Yeah. Joshua, I guess Joshua did that.
Okay. So I've asked you to unmute.
Hi.
So then basically when then you go to get the other person to 99, but then you work backwards to see which numbers you need to you need to hit so that the other person doesn't go to 100.
Exactly. So the whole strategy is you have to make sure you are the one saying the number 89, because after 89, whatever that person says, because there is an 11 gap to 100, irrespective of the other person choosing any number between 1 to 10, you will win the game. And then if you see backwards, you just have to ensure that every time after you say the number, the sum should be a 11 multiple plus 1. So it will go from 1, 12, 23, 34, and it will continue till you hit 89, and then yes, yes, I guess everyone is getting, there's a discussion in the chat happening. So that is how this works. So certain things which might seem are dumb luck because you can't control what the other person might say, you can still have a strategy to win the game every time. So now this is a question which we will not completely discuss it till the end. We might later, we have some time left, but let me explain this question to you and y'all can ponder about it because this is an interesting question. So everyone has to choose a number between 0 to 50. The person whose number is closest to the half the average wins, and the winner will get a prize. This is the way, this last 2 points are not as essential, but let's say you want to win. The whole aim is to win. So the question is, what number will you choose? Okay. Keep in mind, your number has to be closest to half the average of everyone who chooses. Yes. Prasati, could you unmute? I guess Devin has.
You could just pick zero.
Yes, you could. But everyone has to pick zero. So it's not a very, very straightforward question. So just ponder upon it for a while. Now, let's talk about dilemmas. The usual dilemmas aren't this exciting, but this one can be. So let's start with that. So consider the situation as we are in students in COVID times, that you don't know any of your classmates and you all are paired up. And the following system is going to be used to grade you because they are coming up with systems to just grade you because they can't take exams apparently. There are two options. Option A, Prasadhi, could you just start preparing for the poll? So there are two options, option A and option B. Now the rules are, if both of you choose option A, you both will get an A+. If both of you choose an option B, you both will get a B+. If one chooses A and the other chooses B, then the person who chooses A gets C+, and the one who chose B will get A+. Given this scenario, what will you choose is the question. Now, remember when
can
I say just remember that when I'm saying you're paired up, I know we live in times where you have technology and phones and contacting people. Just presume that you're not going to contact your pair. You don't know who that person is. You cannot contact them. You cannot discuss with each other what your answers are going to be. You just need to fill up your option. That is all you can do. You cannot discuss. You cannot ask somebody who is, you just have to fill up your option. Okay. Prasiddhi, can you launch the poll? So Prasiddhi is going to launch the poll and just select on what option you will click.
Just let me know when to end the poll.
Okay. So if you there's a lot of up and down happening. A, B. Guys, there are more 16 people left. Guys, don't send me a personal chat of which option, just select on the poll so that we can see which answer gets more. The ones I've already answered can ponder upon why did they answer, like the logic behind why did they choose a certain option. Prasadhi, I think we can end the poll. I guess we have enough answers. Bhavesh Joshi, I've asked you to unmute.
Can you please repeat?
Bhavesh Joshi. Could you ask me? There are two people who have raised hands. So.
Okay. No, there is no Bhavesh Joshi who has raised hand. There is only Omkar and Devin.
So just like unmute them one after the other.
Okay, give me a minute.
I think both of them would choose option B because if they choose option B, then none of them will have the incentive to change to A, because if one of them changes to A, then their grade goes down. So then both will choose option B.
Okay. Is there anyone who wants to add to this or counter this?
Devin, I'm
adding to this because if you choose option A, you either get grade A plus or grade C plus, but if you choose option B, you can either get grade A plus or grade B plus, which is slightly better.
Okay. Okay. So what they are saying is, let's see the payoff. Okay. Let's say this is you and this is your partner. If you both choose A, you're going to get A plus, both of you are going to get A plus. If you both are going to choose B, both of you are going to get B plus. But if you choose B and the partner chooses A, you get an A plus, and vice versa if you choose A and your partner chooses B. So when you first look at the payoff matrix and you think, what is the best outcome that can come out of this? What is the best grades in a whole that these two people can get? It's A positive, right? Because both of them select A and they both get A plus grades, which is the highest grade you can get. But as people were talking, and because of many people who, I guess, Devin and I guess Joshua answered, what people do is the fear that if I choose A and the other person chooses B, then I get a C plus. And both their explanations were very valid. What Devin said was, when I choose, let's say I choose B. So when the other person will choose A, my grade will be A plus, correct? And when the other person chooses B, my grade will be B plus. So I have either one of the two. I have either A plus or I have a B plus. But if I choose A, then if my partner chooses A, I get an A plus and we are happy. But if my partner chooses B, I get a C plus. So here, when I'm choosing A, I have an option to pick from C plus and A plus, which now makes sense to choose the A plus and the B plus, because you have better chances of getting better grade there. Now, the actual problem of this, which is used to explain this theory, is called the, first let's see what is strategic dominance. When a player's best strategy is the same regardless the action of the other player, then that strategy is said to be dominant. Such was the case in the earlier one, that regardless the other person chooses A or chooses B, I am better off choosing B. So you choose a B. So B is a strategic dominance move here. Now the actual issue or the actual problem was not students grading each other. The question was prisoner's dilemma. Now that everyone has discussed, let's see still what your choice will be. Prasithi, can you start making the second poll? So there are two criminals are caught by the police for committing a crime for which the police has not much evidence to convict them to serve the full sentence. The police feels that the crime is committed by both of them together. Both the criminals are put in separate cells and questioned by the police. And these are the conditions. If both of them deny the crime, they say that we haven't done it, then they both get 2 years of prison. If one confesses and the other denies, then the one who confessed that yes, we have done the crime will get only 1 year of imprisonment. And the one who denies gets 5 years of imprisonment. And if both of them confess, okay, yes, we have done the crime, they both get 3 years imprisonment. So what would you choose in this case if you were one of the prisoners? Prasithi, could you like launch the poll?
It has been launched.
Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Prasithi, I think we can end the poll enough. Most of the people have done the poll.
Sure. I'll end the poll.
Okay, so this time many of y'all said that we'll confess rather than deny, which seems that Now you're getting how to behave when in such situations. So the payoff matrix might look like this. So yeah, sharing the poll. So when you both confess, you both are going to get 3 years. So again, in this situation also, if you just see without knowing anything, the best possible outcome for both of them was to just deny the crime, and both of them will get 2 years of imprisonment. But we tend to confess because of the fear that what if I deny and the other person confesses? Then I'll have to serve 5 years, which is not that great. I would rather confess and be okay with 3 years of imprisonment. So even though this is the most optimum solution to your bare eye, that oh, both of them will get 2 years, most of the people end up being here where they both get 3 years of imprisonment. Now this game is nice. You're like, oh, people behave like this. But what about it in the real world? Like, what happens, right? So there's something called as Nash equilibrium, which says, I guess this is what was this topic or this explanation was kind of touched by Joshua in the first explanation that he gave. That Nash equilibrium is a concept within a game theory where the optimal outcome of a game is where there is no incentive to deviate from the initial strategy. Like he said in the earlier one, if you both are saying option B, then none of you have an incentive to change to option A, because if you change to option A, you will get a C+, which you don't want. Similarly, in the next prisoner's dilemma, when you both are confessing a crime, no one has an incentive to deny the crime, because now if you deny, instead of 3, you will get 5 years of imprisonment. So these are a few places where these theories actually are used, and you can see the effect of these theories in such places. Okay, there's a lot of chats. Guys, if you have any questions, it would be better if you just raise your hand rather than texting me, because it's not very easy for me to see the chat while presenting the slide. So like firms trying to get the larger market share by advertising, or countries competing against each other in a war, or even as simple as a daily thing of approaching first to make a friendship, because you're always scared that what if I go first and that then that person doesn't want to be friends. So you are left with embarrassment and that awkwardness. So you'd just rather not approach first, or even following beauty standards for that matter. So if the first example to see the payoff, if let's say A and B are companies who have an equal share of, let's say, audience. So if you see with bare eye, the profits are better here. They both are better off of both of them making 100 and 100 profit when they're not advertising, because they don't have to pay and fund advertising. But most of the times we end up here because of the, again, the fear that what if I don't advertise and the other company will advertise? Then my profits will reduce drastically and you don't want that. So you're okay with being at 90 rather than taking the risk of being at 100 and then dropping directly to 50. Same way, a bigger question is whether to use nuclear weapons or not, or to like make nuclear weapons or not. The best option is no one dies. Nobody has nuclear weapons, so no one can use them, so no one will die. But what happens is, what if the other country suddenly decides to have nuclear weapons? So then, because of that fear, people or countries in general have nuclear weapons. So now they are told that they won't strike first and everything. But making of weapons, the best way it could have been is no one has nuclear weapons. Nothing can go wrong. but that is not the case most of the times. So mathematics is the music of reason. This is said by James Joseph Sylvester. And in all this entire slide that we did, I don't think there were too much numbers. I don't think we sat and calculated except for the game that me and Prasiddhi played. But all of this had maths in it, and a major portion of it was maths. So, and that is why mathematical thinking, the notion that we have of mathematical thinking, is very wrong. At least the way I have seen my classmates and my friends see things of maths and look at it, oh, what is the point of this? What will I do knowing trigonometry? But that is not, it's the way you think. It's the way you train your brain to make decisions is what maths is and how to approach things. So yeah, that's it. If you all have questions, I think I should stop sharing screen and then you all can ask some questions. Chat.
Most of the chat comments are responses to the various questions. So we'll wait for a couple of minutes for audience.
Yeah, I'll just check my direct chats because I've received a lot of them. Someone said that, but I can't see it here. But okay, the question that they posted was, wouldn't it be like if everyone knows that now you're going to be choosing B and you're choosing B because, you know, you don't want to risk it. But then if everyone knows that, then why can't everyone like conclusively decide, you know what, we are doing this, but why not choose B? I guess that was it Joshua? Someone has a message. So the thing is, here you are, see, if my partner was someone who I knew or was a friend of mine or who I trusted, there's a higher chance of me thinking that, you know what, if I will put A, even my friend will put A, because we both care for each other's achievements also. So then we both can get A positive. But that is not how you can't get, when you are doing game theory, the assumption is that you are a rational person. And your rational person means you are only looking for your own interest at first. You are not seeing any relation that you have with the other person you are playing with. Then if you get that, those things into it, there's a lot of nuance that you'll have to go through. Because people might even do stuff because they don't like you. So how do you know? So in such cases, you don't have to presume that you have a certain type of relation or understanding with the other person. You have to be completely different. What is your experience at Princeton? So I can, no doubt, there's no doubt that I can say it was one of the best experiences I had. The exposure, the things, the topics that we covered, the interactions, the course itself, and the interactions with the peers. Even after the course, we used to sit, discuss a lot of things from the course, outside the course, and like share our viewpoints or the way we approach things. Also, apart from the course, in keeping the course thing aside, the whole, for me, it was the first time I was staying completely, like, traveled alone, and I was there alone, staying with strangers. We became friends over a time, but staying alone, managing everything alone. So I would say it was one of the best experiences of the excitement. And the campus, Princeton, if you have to talk about Princeton, it's very pretty. It's a very pretty place. But the main takeaway from the course will be the interactions that I had with the peers there. It has to be that. We used to skip meals rather, just to discuss certain things that we wanted to clarify. Omkar, Prasiddhi, could you unmute Omkar? He has asked me to unmute him.
So my question was that if you played that game multiple times, then wouldn't there be a change that they would prefer denying?
Yes. So that is where, so the thing is, Nash Equilibrium also states that it can go from either everyone cooperates or none of them cooperate. So the equilibrium can shift from one to the other extreme. But as you said, again, in such cases, even if you play it many times, if as a human, yes, you will change. That's what I said. If you take considerations of, we'll realize, oh, that person will do this. Maybe they'll realize. If you're thinking as a rational person, you only care about yourself. You cannot trust the other person. You don't know what the other person might do. But the dominant strategy won't let you shift from one to the other, but the Nash equilibrium will, if you play it a multiple number of times continuously. So then that Nash equilibrium covers that concept. I think you should read more into what Nash equilibrium talks about to understand that, because that's a very valid point. Because everyone will realize, right, that we could be better. Why are we staying here? But then how do you know you can trust the other person? Okay. What are your hobbies? I love doing maths. I sing. There's a lot, actually. I'm in part with everything. I dance, I sing, I read, kind of. So there's not much. What we need to have improved in our schooling system based on your experience at Princeton? I guess keeping the whole schooling system over here, or even over there, I guess, up till a point, is we keep subjects very separate. Like maths lecture, then this chemistry lecture is different, and then there's English and humanities is different. Where I think there is a lot of interconnections between the subjects. And if we are taught those subjects in a way we can connect these subjects to each other, they become much, much more so interesting. So putting subjects into boxes is one of the major things that I think could really drastically change how education system and how students perceive studying. Okay, so we have some time. So let's say, Joshua, could you unmute yourself? Or wait, I'll have to. To understand what exactly. Could you, I know you were you gave a very, very reasonable reason to choose B, but let's say you are in a debate and your debate side is you have to choose A, what will be your points? How do you convince someone to choose an A?
It's the moral reason. Then if you choose, because other players are also looking to find the optimal solution. So then you have to work with them, not against them. Because if both of you deny, then both of you get worse. But if one of you at least chooses A, then the sooner, most of the time, it will be the better option for you in the long run.
Let's say we both are playing, okay? And you were trying to convince me that we should choose A. Okay, so what will you tell me? What incentive will you give me to choose A?
If we both choose A, then we get lower tilt.
Okay, but now that I'm convinced that because you are telling me that you're going to choose A, I am convinced that you are going to choose A. So then I can choose B and still get an A plus and give you a C plus.
Mm.
So then why should I change to A? Let us go back to the, maybe if you want to see the slide. Yeah, you have this in front of you and you're trying to convince me to choose A.
So, if we choose A, then the worst case scenario is that one of us gets a C, the other gets an A plus. But if we choose B, the worst case scenario is that we both get B plus.
Yes.
How can I?
What if I say that you're convincing me to choose A? And let's say I get convinced also. But then you ditch on the plan and you choose B.
So I could do that, but if I already convinced you, then I will choose A, then both of us will get A.
But that's the thing, right? How do you know that I'm going to choose A?
I don't, but at least I've done the right thing. I'm not sure about this one.
Vaishnavi is saying, I will tell that I will be choosing B. That's interesting. Isn't that like the obvious solution? So you're still telling them that you're going to choose B. Vaishnavi, could you unmute yourself?
Yes.
Yeah, you're saying you will tell that you will choose B, but isn't B already like the option that we are on? So why will you have to tell people that you are choosing B? I can't. Is she still on mute or am I not? Okay, Vaishnavi.
Sanaya, you want me to unmute everyone?
Yeah, I guess that should be fine now. Yeah, we can do that. Okay, Vaishnavi is messy because they will be forced to choose A and then maybe I choose A. If you choose B, why will they be forced to choose A? why will they choose A? If they choose A, they will go to C plus, right? If you are telling them you're going to choose B, then even they'll choose B, because choosing A is worse off for them.
Right. Now I realized that I made the wrong decision.
Sorry, Prasithi, I couldn't get you.
You could tell them that what people will think of them if they choose the other option.
See, that all works when you are a human, but if you are a rational person, you don't care what other people. So this is what the theory doesn't say. This is how it will always be. It is just a framework when you're assuming that every person is a rational person, which we, none of us is a rational person to begin with. We all have different things and emotions and reputations to maintain. So we are not at all rational. But when you are, if you get every factor into it, you will never be able to decide what will happen. So when you're analyzing game theory or any other strategy, if the assumption is that you are a rational person. So if you, even if you tell that what will other people think, that should not make the other person change their answer.
Are we allowed to tell other people what we are choosing?
Are you allowed to tell other people what we are choosing? Yes, you can do that. Let's in the other case, you were not able to. Let's assume you are allowed to tell now that you can choose.
So I'll find a person who's willing to choose A and I'll choose A with her.
Willing to choose? How do you know he's willing? He'll say he's willing, but he will not. How can you control that?
It's a rational person, right? So he or her.
I said rational. I didn't say truthful.
Oh. But why would they lie? I mean, if we both choose A, then both of us get an A+. If he lies, he gets an A+, I get lower. So unless he wants to be first in the class.
Exactly. That's the best case for him, right? Assume you are in a competition where everyone has got the gold medal. And you go and tell them that, oh, I got gold medal. But then they say that everyone has got it. But then you go for the next competition and you are the only one who got the gold medal. Which is a better case for you?
The second one.
Yes, Hariharan, sir. So changed.
So the thing is that you don't know the pair, right? That's the biggest problem here. Yeah. So you will need everyone to select A for that. Whoever was telling or convincing others to select A, because only if everyone selects A, then only you have 100% chance of getting A+. Because if one person doesn't select A and you are paired with that person, then you're gone. You will get C and other person gets a better grade. So the key point here is you don't know your pair.
Yes. So. Does that clarify, Mayank? Any other questions?
Is it better off that we tell each other what we're choosing or not? Like, if you want to win.
Are you asking me that is it better to tell what you are choosing if you want to win?
Yeah. The tell as in lie or tell the truth.
If you get up and tell me that, okay, I'm going to choose A. Again, how do I know you will choose A? So you saying you will choose something is not a guarantee that you will. So it shouldn't, for if you're talking about rationality, in humans, yes, if you get up and you're convincing and you're telling people like, okay, this and this is the reason and that is the reason why you should choose A, maybe yes, but in this scenario, it shouldn't. It shouldn't matter if you say or no.
So what if I convince that person that I'll be choosing B? So if that person is a rational person and he wants to get the higher grade, he'll choose A.
No, if you choose B and the other person, if you are choosing A and the other person is choosing B, then the person who chose A gets C+. The person who chose B will get an A+. It's the other way around.
Oh, right. Sorry.
It can be a bit confusing.
Saraya, we are just running out of time.
Yes, yes.
We have a couple of minutes more. I want to ask you a question. At the end of the day, you want to apply this to real life scenarios and see the value of it. But what you said is under the assumption that people are rational and they think and make their decisions. But in real life, a lot of decisions are made in irrational ways. So how do you connect this ideal thing, your ability to estimate or predict, to a real life scenario? How is it being really used in practice?
The way I think of it is that this gives you a... It's like even in any sciences, you are doing physics experiment in an ideal situation. It's not going to happen. I'm not going to be in vacuum. But you're still doing it to see that if this thing is put under this condition, then what are the possible things that could happen? So it's like giving you a framework that...
So in real life, there is friction, for example. But I know how to account for friction. I can introduce the additional frictional force and then bring that ideal experiment to a real life situation. There is a way to do that in physics. So in real life, in the case of decision making, if you assume that people are rational and come up with a theoretical prediction, and then we realize that people actually have certain biases, certain cognitive biases that comes in the way of decision making, is there a way to apply those corrections and still say what would be the most probable decisions that will happen?
That is where there is a difference between science, natural sciences and social sciences, right? When humans are involved, you cannot be 100% sure of anything. Of anything, how many ever times you have tested the same thing on millions of people and they have done the same thing, there can be this one person who will not do the same thing. So, in social sciences, in sciences, as you said, you can actually physically apply that, okay, now I'm going to exert friction and it's going to happen and see the results. But in social sciences, you can't. So you just have to take your chance. You can give a range that maybe it can vary from here to here. So 100% surety, though, you will not get only in social sciences. I don't even think we should strive for that. You're not... It will make you mad because you will never reach that. So I don't think that should be the aim of predicting the exact thing that's going to happen.
One more question. Okay. We look at what is good for the individual versus what is good for everybody. Okay. Then there is a moral thing in terms of what is the right thing to do. So all this rational decisions and stuff like that is also supportive of doing the right thing, morally the right thing, or do you see that they are at opposite ends many a times? How do you see the connection between these two? Being rational and being moral and doing the right thing.
Yes. They are. Being rational doesn't imply being moral. Because in at least when we are studying this, it said when irrational, you are thinking of what is the best for you as an individual. Now, that can be the worst scenario for everyone else, so which is not moral, but it is rational. So it is yes, Harihar and sir.
other point is, if I think what is good for everybody rather than just thinking what is good for me, will that also be the rational decision?
Individual, no, it won't. Most, it could be, it could overlap. Sometimes wanting the good for everyone can be the best for you. But then again, it is a very individual scenario, situation thing of which scenario you put in. Yes, sorry, Arun, sir.
So Shankar sir, you asked yes. about how we apply this thing in the real case. So yes. One of the ways in which we can think of the same problem that Sanaya was talking about, asking A and B, and we know that A is a better option if everyone selects A. So one thing that can be done is one person tries to convince everyone, but I don't know how much that will actually help, because there is always an incentive to select B, because if others are selecting A and I select B, I get better outcomes. So in that case, there is a role for contract, because now if you want to enforce something, you will have to bring in legal ways of enforcing things. So that's how we can learn from this decision making game theory and stuff like that. So let's think about something like COVID vaccines, right? When COVID was at its peak, as an individual, if I am young, I know that the risk of COVID is less for me. But at the same time, if I am not careful, I can pass on the risk of COVID to someone else who has been careful. And therefore, my decisions have externalities attached to it. So my decisions have an impact on someone else, and I don't internalize those externalities, because they don't affect me. And that's where the role of regulation comes in. If you want to externalize, or if you want to internalize some of the external impacts of your own decision. So there is a role for regulation in there. So that's how we can see how this gets affected.
Sure, sure. I think this is such an interesting topic. I think we should meet again and have a follow-up talk around this topic. It would be really good. And we should budget enough time for a good discussion and make it a lot more interactive, because all these polls and quizzes are actually helping to bring diverse viewpoints and convince people in terms of there could be so many different views on this, what is the best solution for a given situation. I think you did a great job, Sanaya, in terms of triggering the curiosity amongst the audience for problems that are so interesting and so fundamental in terms of, we all make decisions day in and day out. So it's there is so much of opportunity for us to do it in a much more intelligent, much more structured way. So this has really opened up a lot of thinking and a lot of fresh ideas around this topic. I'm sure many of this audience would now go back and read up a bit more about the prisoner's dilemma and many other popular examples in game theory. And I'm sure we'll be able to get back to you for another follow-up talk on the same subject very soon. Sure. Thanks a ton for making this talk so interesting. Thanks a lot.
Thanks.
Over to you, Prasiddhi.
Sure. Thank you so much.
So thank you so much, Sanaya, for giving this wonderful and engaging and enriching talk, which inspired so many of us, and sharing your food of thought. So thank you so much for that wonderful session. And thank you so much, Dr. Shankar, for giving us the opportunity to share and spread awareness. And thank you, the entire audience, for joining us and listening to Sanaya's talk. So as I mentioned at the beginning of our session, that there is a special announcement and an important announcement that I want to make. So here it is. Well, on the last day of Navratri Tech Talks, in our last session, I will be, so that is 17th of October, in our 7 to 8 slot, I'll be running a quiz. So Prasiddhi Forest Foundation will be running a quiz regarding all the sessions of Navratri Tech Talks. And the winner of that session is going to get an exclusively curated G3 Eco Kit. which was exclusively curated under the guidance of Dr. Kiran Bedi ma'am. So while doing several of my plantations in public schools of Pondicherry, I got an opportunity to connect with her, and she really liked the idea of G3 EcoKit. And so I have even launched it in Pondicherry under her guidance. And so she really liked it. So here is a small audio visual. Just a second. Here is a small audio visual about how G3 looks and what will be inside it. What is G3 EcoKit? So this is a part of G3 curriculum. In G3 curriculum, there are two elements. That is, one is a session where you connect with experts, and one is this kit. So in G3, there are three genes. Generate your own oxygen, grow your own food, and gift the community. This is a total ecosystem which I have built so that all the people can get hands-on experience and start with their sustainable journey. So in this kit, this is not basically a kit actually, G3. There are even sessions which will be conducted by experts and all. So there are three G's. So for generate your own oxygen, I have given a seed ball, which you can throw anywhere and it will grow into a tree once got in contact with water. Then in G2, there is a small grow kit like with the coco pit, garden tool, the germination pots, two metal pots through which you can grow your fruits and vegetables. Then in the third G, that is gift to community, there is one terracotta pot, some color paints and a brush. So you can paint it and keep grains and water for the birds and animals. And there is a special gift where there will be an envelope in which you can put, so when you consume the fruits or vegetables, you can dry the seeds and then put it in the envelope and send it to me. So the address will also be given over there. And through this, you can also start with your sustainable journey. So this was all about G3 EcoKit. But friends, the journey will not be easy. If you want this kit, you have to join all the sessions and get amazing insights from the speakers. And in the quiz, if you win, the kit is yours. So don't forget to join us tomorrow in an amazing session with one more amazing genius. And thank you so much, Sanaya, for giving today's spectacular talk.
Thanks, Prasiddhi. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, audience. And we look forward to meeting you all again at 6 o'clock tomorrow for the next talk in this series. And thanks a lot, Sanaya, for your valuable time today. Thanks a ton.
So before we conclude our session, I request all of you to on your cameras. And so we'll take a screenshot to save this memory. So you can do a thumbs up and we can say Happy Navratri. Okay.
We'll also say G3.
Yes, sure. Happy
Navratri. G3, G1, G2, G3, Happy Navratri.
Yes.
Spectacular. Spectacular and wonderful. So thank you so much, all of you, for joining. And don't forget to join tomorrow's amazing session. So thank you and bye-bye. And on this note, I conclude today's amazing Navratri Tech Talks. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.